saying we need to have a DRP to vote on immediately. Now you're proposing that we introduce a one-house bill and go to joint conference committees? Senator DeFrancisco, how many weeks do you want to stay here? Senator Diaz, his steam is coming out of his ears just listening to that proposal.
Senator Schneiderman, that's clever. But the point was, will you, my question is simple. In your negotiations that are supposedly going on, would you tell us, the rest of your colleagues in the Senate, what you're willing to cut and what you're fighting for as a replacement to the school aid cuts and the health care cuts? Would you do that?
Yes, I will tell you everything I know. Let's finish up here, and then we can have a conversation. But I know there have been ongoing conversations. I have no objection to some communication, but you know as well as I do that the parameters that are set then are negotiated and renegotiated. But I think that on the issue of school aid, I think we are, if we're not in exactly the same place, we're pretty much in the same place. But, and this is, you know, we're not going to discuss this here today. The issue before us now is, while these discussions are going on, while the finance staffs are talking, are you going to allow us to go forward and vote on these four worthwhile bills? Are you going to take the position that we should do no other legislative business until we have a final three-way deal that's on the floor?
To answer your question, that is correct. I was very clear in the motion I was making, so we get to the point. But I guess your answer
to I'm correct in what?
You're correct. That's exactly what I want to do. I want to deal with the deficit reduction and the bill that I've been fighting for that's on this agenda for 6 years on biannual settlements. It could wait a couple of months until we get the deficit taken care of. So last question, if you would agree, please.
Senator Schneiderman.
Last question.
Yes. So are you saying you don't know what your conference is willing to cut, or your conference has not come out with any specific cuts at this point in time?
Senator Montgomery, why do you rise?
Thank you. Madam President, we were discussing I thought I had the floor,
excuse me, and was asking Senator Schneiderman a question and was just waiting for an answer.
And I yield to Senator Montgomery.
You're not going to make a good attorney general like that.
Who has the working mic, I might say. Senator Montgomery.
May I just raise a point of order? This was raised by Senator Klein before, and I thought that the debate that we were having was on acceptance of the Rules Committee. So Senator DeFrancisco insists on debating the budget. So, Madam President, how can we bring this discussion back to the germane issue, and that is the Rules Committee? That's what we want to vote on right now.
Well, Senator Schneiderman, are
thank you. Thank you, Madam President. That's the point that I would make, Senator DeFrancisco. I think that we should finish our conversation after we've resolved this issue. I'm happy to talk with you and encourage people to talk with you and have our staffs talk with each other about what's going on as far as the budget goes. The only relevant answer to the current debate is the fact that there is not a three-way deal. We do not have a deficit reduction package to vote on right now. We should, and I would suggest that we please call the question on whether we're going to be able to vote on any other legislation today or not, because there clearly is nothing else to vote on regarding the DRP. Madam President.
I appreciate that, and I do believe we have two more speakers, hopefully on the issue of whether or not we will be accepting the rules report. Senator Bonasse?
Thank you, Madam President. You know, the more we go back and forth, I think the more we embarrass ourselves in the Senate. And I don't think any member here would say that the stuff coming out of the Rules Committee, the four bills, is not important. It is important. I know Senator Klein has worked hard on his foreclosure bill, and it does affect people that are hurting and are vulnerable. So, but I think we all agree that the budget deficit reduction is a high, probably the highest priority we should be addressing in the Senate. Now, I'm not going to embarrass my colleagues on the other side. I'm not going to mention any senator by name. It's not my intent. But you can't tell me that there are not senators on the other side of the aisle that believe we should start doing something on budget deficit, even if we can't get a consensus. The governor has said the blame is with the Senate Democrats. Governor has said that. I'm not making it up. The speaker said we're prepared to
do. Senator Bonacek, I really am asking, as we draw this debate to an end, that we deal with the issue of whether to accept the rules report.
Well, I'll bring it back to whether we should or should not accept the rules report. All right,
Madam
President?
Would you be doing that?
I will.
In the next couple of seconds?
In the next 30 seconds. Apparently, all the blame.
Senator Klein, why do you rise?
Madam President, there's been many senators speaking on a specific issue. Senator Montgomery, I please ask you, Madam President, to rule on the germaneness of this debate, originally brought up by Senator DeFrancisco. According to Rule 9, Section 8, a debate shall only be in order when it's germane to the question under discussion. Please, Madam President, please rule.
All right. I believe that I've been asked to make a ruling on the germaneness of this conversation. Senator Limbus.
I believe that Senator Bonacek has the right to speak, and as he speaks, the germaneness of the issue is quite clear. And to curtail his speech before he can...
Madam President, once again, Madam President, I made a point of order. A point of order overrules whatever my distinguished colleague says. And I ask you to rule on this germaneness issue.
All right. Well, all right, we...
Madam President, again, please rule on this.
Right, so rather than continue back and forth, I think we will rule on the germaneness issue. And Senator Bonacek, I will be ruling you out of order. And I think we should get to the calling the question. The question. Question before the House is whether the decision of the chair shall stand as the judgment of the Senate. All those in favor of open. All those in favor of overruling the decision of the chair, please signify by raising your hands. Overruling the chair. Secretary will announce the results.
Ayes 30, nays 32.
Having failed to obtain the necessary votes, the ruling of the chair is sustained. The appeal is denied. Shall we?
Madam President?
Senator Klein.
I move to accept the report of the Rules Committee at this time.
All those in favor of accepting the Rules Committee report, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Nay?
Nay. not a motion. No, sir. No,
sir. Okay. This is not a bill we're debating. This is a report of the Rules Committee. The Rules Committee is adopted. Senator Klein.
Madam President, has the Rules Committee report been adopted?
Yes, it has been adopted, Senator.
At this time, could we please move to a reading of the calendar?
The Secretary will read Extraordinary Session Calendar 2.
Calendar number 3 by Senator Thompson, Senate Print 4A, an act to amend the general municipal law.
The bill is laid aside. The Senate will stand.
first bill on the calendar.
It's calendar. Announce the results.
Aye 62, nays 0.
The bill is passed. The secretary will continue to read.
Calendar number 5 by Senator Klein. Extraordinary session print number 7, an act to amend the real property actions and proceeding law and others.
Madam President, is there a message of necessity at the desk?
There is a message of necessity here at the desk, Senator.
Please move to accept the message of necessity.
All those in favor of accepting the message of necessity signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. The message of necessity is accepted. Read the last section.
Section 25, this act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Adams, Espada, Kruger, Skelos, Smith, Young.
Senator DeFrancisco to explain his vote.
Yeah, thank you, Madam President. In this new world of openness and that we have, that the majority came into office under and that previously sued the majority about, we're now accepting a message of necessity of a bill that was printed moments ago that has a far-reaching effect on the mortgage industry, I believe, and municipalities throughout the state. I just wanted to point out that there seems to be a disconnect with campaigns and actual fact, and hopefully people would begin to realize that. On the substance of the bill, this bill would require the bank to be responsible for doing all maintenance on a building from the time a judgment of foreclosure was obtained, whatever that means. I don't know if that means ordered. I don't mean if that means filed and served. I don't know what that means. But after that process, then you have advertisement, which takes weeks. You have a referee to be appointed. You have a process in order for the sale to take place. It could be many, many months that the bank is responsible for a property that they don't even have title to, and they can't get liability insurance for because they don't have title to the property. I just think that if that doesn't have a chilling effect on mortgages, I'm not quite sure what does. That's why I'm voting no, Madam President.
Senator DeFrancisco to be recorded in the negative. Senator Saland to explain his vote.
Madam President, this bill is an attempt to deal with an issue in which the horse has long since left the barn. There have been multiple efforts to try and deal with trying to assist particularly those who had taken subprime mortgages. We're talking now about the mortgage market in general, not merely subprime mortgages. Banks certainly today, given the economic conditions of our time, are far more selective in terms of those to whom they're willing to loan money to. I fear that the net result of this is going to be basically not only, as Senator DeFrancisco just mentioned, a chilling effect on mortgages, but it's making it very, very difficult, far more difficult for young people to be able to obtain mortgages. The costs are going to have to be built in somewhere, whether it's going to be in origination fees, whether it's going to be more for credit checks, whether it's going to be more for paperwork, whatever it is. Banks are going to build this into their process. So while it might afford some degree of comfort to say, look what we have accomplished, I think in the long run, the people who lose are consumers, particularly anybody who is interested in trying to get into a home now and after the adoption of this, and certainly the votes are there to adopt it. I certainly find the intent laudable, and can't be critical of the sponsor or sponsors for their intent, but perhaps the consequences are unintended, but the consequences are that people such as my family, one of my children, anticipates being married in the not too distant future and applying for a mortgage, This is going to make it that much more difficult for he and his wife to obtain a mortgage. And I can't support this measure and therefore will cast my vote no.
Senator Solange will be recorded in the negative. Senator Farley.
Thank you, Madam President. This is not a perfect bill by any means. I've looked at it very carefully and read all parts of it, talked with the sponsor. There's negatives to it, there's no question about it, but it is critically important in this respect. Many homeowners in this state and in their neighborhoods continue to struggle with foreclosures that denigrate the neighborhood, and they're looking for these homes to be taken care of. Now, is this a major problem in New York State? No, it is not, because we are not among the leaders in foreclosures in the nation. But it is a major problem. Yes, this might increase the cost, which will be passed on to borrowers. There's concerns about the timing, that the duty that, to maintain these provisions. I've spoken with the bankers. This may have a chilling effect on loans for multiple dwellings, to say the least. Now, there is a concern that a grave concern that really almost brought me to the point of voting against this. This is where the lender becomes liable for the property in a multiple dwelling, particularly maybe with a slum landlord continuing to collect the rent, even though he's somewhat abandoned the property. And Senator Klein has assured me that he's going to consider a chapter amendment to try to address this. We're not here to enrich slum landlords. But this is a major bill which the people of this state of New York, they really don't care or know who is it that's supposed to maintain the property. But almost every responsible bank that I know of wants to protect their asset, whether they have title or not. They want to protect this asset, and they should. And I've spoken to bank presidents and members of the bank boards that say, particularly in the upstate area, that we want to protect our assets.
Senator
we want
Farley,
to protect our...
How do you vote?
It's I'm going to vote aye. I have
Thank
worked
you.
In this area for a lot of years, and I think that this bill is one that deserves an aye vote.
Senator Farley to be recorded in the affirmative. Senator Liz Krueger.
Thank you, Madam. I rise to support the bill and to say that I will be proudly voting for it. I'm pleased that Senator Farley just voiced his support for the bill. So just one clarification. Foreclosures are a serious problem in our state. The fact that some other states might have a worse situation doesn't reduce the crisis. We have a staggering 58,000 outstanding mortgage loans in New York State facing delinquency in September 2009. In the next 4 years, it's estimated that 230,000 households are expected to be lost in a foreclosure, costing the state's economy $4 billion. It is no question that this is a crucial bill to pass. There are some basic protections in here, basic notification that people need to have so that they can, in fact, get the counseling they need to try to protect themselves and their home. There are some basic protections in there that if you foreclose on a property, you are the owner and you must maintain the home, whether it's a single family or an apartment, to standards of the law. This is a win-win for communities and for individuals facing foreclosure. And I'm sorry, I would define this as an emergency calling for a message of necessity, because it is years too late. We are years late in getting this legislation done. So I'm proud that we are finally taking it up tonight. Hope that we are going to pass it and that the governor will sign it into law. Thank you, Madam President.
Senator Liz Krueger to be recorded in the affirmative. Senator Hassel-Thompson.
Very briefly to explain my vote. You just heard the statistics that were put forth by Senator Liz Krueger. Let me just add a couple that may not have been brought to your attention. There is no New Yorker or area of this state that is going to be immune to the deep and lasting economic impact of this crisis. This foreclosure crisis, and maybe this is why people are not don't think that this is a major concern, but this foreclosure crisis has been felt most acutely in communities of color due to the prevalence of subprime lending that was targeted to these communities specifically. The Furman Center for Real Estate and Urban Policy reports that in New York City, the most predominantly minority neighborhoods that saw the highest rate of subprime lending are now experiencing the highest rates of foreclosure. If that's not a crisis, Madam President, I don't know what is. Thank you.
Senator Hassel-Thompson to be recorded in the affirmative. Senator Foley.
Thank you, Madam President. Just to add to what Senator Hassel-Thompson just mentioned, this past weekend I had a great good fortune to help literally almost 300 homeowners in the Central ISIP community where my office had held a mortgage foreclosure clinic. And the hope that we brought those folks, the hope and in many cases the help that we gave them, was certainly something that we should be very, very proud of, and it is emblematic, as the Senator just mentioned, of how communities of color were preyed upon by irresponsible moneylenders. And as a matter of fact, why this particular piece of legislation is so important, among other reasons, one of the things we heard time and time again on Saturday was the fact that there are unscrupulous mortgage scams where they require upfront payment, not of hundreds of dollars, Madam President, but thousands of dollars. And when I saw this weekend grown men and women who came to tears because they lost $2,000, $3,000, $4,000, that requires immediate attention. This is an emergency piece of legislation that I must say that I'm very proud that we're taking this up tonight. And yes, this should have been passed years ago, but we are doing it tonight. This is building upon last year's particular mortgage foreclosure reform when Senator Farley was the chair of the Banking Committee. They had a broad bipartisan support that year, as this does this year. So I'm very, very pleased and most happy that this is being done tonight. It would have been wrong to delay this by months, and we can bring some real relief to the future of to folks throughout this state by passing this legislation tonight. And it will show that the long trek that we took to come up here tonight to Albany was well worth the effort when we passed this legislation tonight. Thank you, Madam President.
Senator Foley to be recorded in the affirmative. Senator C. Johnson.
Thank you very much, Madam President. I too rise to support this critical piece of legislation. And whether it was Senator Foley who had his seminar this past weekend or the one that I held last year, where we saw a couple hundred people from the affluent areas of my district coming in and sitting down with their bankers and literally begging them for relief. This is a critical piece of legislation. It's one that I'm proud to be supporting. But I also wish to thank the sponsor, Senator Jeffrey Klein, the Deputy Majority Leader, who has made this an important piece of our, the New York State Senate's, legislative goals. I wish to commend him on his leadership for this particular issue. I thank Senator Farley, who I know when he chaired the Banking Committee also took this under task. But this is an important piece. It's vital to the health of our economy to make sure that our homeowners are protected. I'll be voting yes. Thank you very much, Madam President.
Senator Craig Johnson to be recorded in the affirmative. Senator Klein to explain his vote.
I want to thank our governor, the assembly. It was a long time coming to finally put together, as many of my colleagues said, this very, very important piece of legislation. By the way, I can't think of any other piece of legislation that would belong on the governor's list of an extraordinary session, because whether some of my colleagues agree or not, this is a huge problem which affects each and every one of us. One of the things that I've been warning about for the past 2 years is whether or not you have a home that's ready to be foreclosed upon, whether or not you have a subprime loan, this is truly an issue that affects each and every one of us. And this legislation really goes a long way towards actually helping those people who are innocent bystanders, by the way, of the subprime fallout. What we're doing in this legislation is preventing property values from going down. There's been national studies which show that for every foreclosed property on a block, the surrounding properties go down anywhere from $18,000 to $25,000 per foreclosed property. We're also seeing crime going up in areas that have large numbers of foreclosure. This legislation, as far as requiring the lending institutions to maintain their foreclosed property, is twofold. We have two standards. One is a lesser standard. If there's actually no one living in the premises, which means they would have to just take care of the outside, make sure it's not a blight on the community. And if there's actually a tenant in the property, they have to maintain it as the local ordinance would require. So I don't think we're reinventing the wheel here. I don't think we're putting an undue burden on the lending institution, which was very quick, by the way, to foreclose in the first place, and now should be responsible for their property. We're not asking them to maintain this property any more than the average homeowner would have to maintain this property. And I think the result, at the end of the day, is going to be good for everyone. It's going to make sure that our communities do not have foreclosed properties, which cause a problem for innocent homeowners. We won't see the decline of home values because of these foreclosed properties. And at the end of the day, I'm optimistic to think that our real estate market will come back. And at that time, the lending institution, which will take possession and own the property, will have a valuable piece of property that they can sell. Not some run-down property that no one would ever think of buying and which is an eyesore to a community. The other piece, which I think is just as important, another innocent bystander in all this, is the tenant. This legislation would now require that the lending institution notify a tenant when they are actually in foreclosure. I know I'm going to wrap up, Madam President. That they notify that the property is being foreclosed upon and there's actually someone other than the person renting the property taking title to this premises. So, Madam President, I thank both my colleagues on both sides of the aisle who support this legislation. I just want to get the point across that this is not an issue that just affects downstate communities. It's an issue that affects us all over the state of New York because there is not one county within our state that doesn't have their fair foreclosures. I vote yes, Madam President.
Senator Klein to be recorded in the affirmative. Is there any other senator who wishes to explain his or her vote? Announce the results, please.
Those recorded in the negative on calendar number 5 are senators DeFrancisco, Golden, Griffo, O. Johnson, Little, Marcelino, Ranzenhofer, Saland, Seward, Skelos, Volker, Winner, and Young. Also, Senator Nozzolio. Ayes 48, nays 14.
The bill is passed. Secretary will continue to read.
Thank you. Calendar number 6, by Senator Breslin, extraordinary session print number 9, an act to amend the insurance law.
Senator Klein.
Madam President, is there a message of necessity at the desk?
There is a message of necessity here at the desk, Senator.
I move to accept the message of necessity.
All those in favor of accepting the message of necessity signify by saying aye. Opposed, nay. The message of necessity is accepted. Read the last section.
Section 21, this act shall take effect on the 180th day.
Call the roll.
Adams, Espada, Kruger, Skelos, Smith, Young.
Senator... Senator DeFrancisco to explain his vote?
We probably could explain it jointly, Senator Seward and I, because we've worked on this bill for about 5 or 6 years, and it passed the Senate last year, and unfortunately never passed the Assembly. The bill is very much like it was back then, and it's an important bill not only in regulating the viatical settlement industry, but also allowing consumers' own life insurance policies to sell these on the open market to those who want to pay for the value of that policy. It's a very, very important bill, but I want to make it clear, not as important as the deficit reduction plan. But since my motion failed, I vote aye on this bill.
Senator DeFrancisco to be recorded in the affirmative. Senator Seward to explain his vote.
Yes, Madam President, I too rise to support Senator Breslin's bill. This is truly landmark legislation, which this year we hope to see final enactment and signed into law by the governor. This is important because for the first time it truly does regulate the life and settlements marketplace in New York State. It specifically prohibits stranger-originated life insurance policies. There are very strong consumer protection disclosure requirements, anti-fraud provisions included in this legislation. It's a balanced bill that is supported by all segments of the industry, from the life insurance companies to the life settlements companies. It does allow people to settle their life insurance policies under the rules and regulations of this legislation, and it is truly a benefit to the people of the state of New York to see final enactment of this bill. I vote aye.
Senator Seward to be recorded in the affirmative. Senator Breslin to explain his vote.
Thank you, Madam President. I echo the remarks of Senator Seward. This is one of the most important pieces of insurance legislation that we will pass over a number of years, albeit it is not the least bit glamorous. But it takes the whole secondary life insurance market, which was subject to predators before regulation. And when I mean predators taking advantage of old people with insurance policies, and I don't think, in disagreeing with Senator DeFrancisco, we could have waited any longer, because I think on almost a daily basis, this marketplace in New York State was being taken advantage of without regulation. And I commend Senator Seward and his staff, and Superintendent Wren, who's here with his key staff, and his predecessor, Eric DiNallo, and the governor's office. It was truly a team effort to get to this point and to get all players, the Life Insurance Council of the State of New York, the Viatica Settlements Association, which is located out of state, and all parties together at the table to finally to make this a regulated market. And New York State, because it is the insurance capital of the world, was placed in an embarrassing situation without regulating this market. And many referred to the secondary life insurance market as the Wild West. We will finally have regulation and finally have a very good regulation with all parties in agreement. I vote aye. Thank you, Madam President.
Thank you, Senator Breslin, to be recorded in the affirmative. Is there any other senator wishing to explain his or her vote? Seeing none, announce the result.
Aye 62, nays 0.
The bill is passed. Senator Klein, that completes the non-controversial reading of the extraordinary session calendar 2.
Madam President, can we now go to a reading of the controversial calendar?
If the secretary would please ring the bells, members are asked to come to the chamber for the controversial reading of extraordinary session calendar number 2. Senator Klein. The Secretary will read.
Calendar number 3 by Senator Thompson, extraordinary session print number 4A, an act to amend the general municipal law.
Senator Klein.
Is there a message of necessity at the desk, Madam President?
There is a message of necessity at the desk, Senator Klein. All those in favor of accepting the message of necessity signify by saying aye. Opposed, nay. The message of necessity is accepted. Read.
Yes, Madam President, while I'm so disappointed, I'm going to
cut off on the last topic of importance to the people of my district, I will exercise my right to ask for an explanation of the bill.
Senator Thompson, an explanation of the bill, please.
It's always a privilege and honor to explain the bill to my fellow colleague from, who's also an alum from SUNY Brockport. Let me say that this is another important bill that promotes our green economy that all of us on both sides of the aisle are moving to achieve in the state of New York. The Municipal Sustainable Energy Loan Program, Property Assessed Clean Energy Bond Program, better known as a PACE bond, is a municipal bond whose proceeds are loaned to both commercial and residential owners to finance energy retrofits such as double insulated windows, install clean energy technology, and others. Owners
Senator Thompson, I'm sorry. Can we please have order in the chamber?
Owners then repay their loans over 20 years via an assessment on their property tax, which takes the same priority as traditional property tax liens and assessments. The Municipal Sustainable Energy Loan Program legislation has zero fiscal impact on the state. It's voluntary for municipalities to adopt and positions these communities to be eligible for $450 million of newly allocated stimulus funding for this PACE pilot program. And we need this legislation so that the state can participate in this program as well. And so I strongly support the bill. I think hopefully everyone will be unanimous in trying to get more money out of Washington, D.C. Thank you.
Are there any other senators wishing to be heard on the bill before us?
Just one other.
Yes, Senator.
Just one other thing. This is something that's important as well to not only the entire Senate, but I also wanted to mention, I want to thank my colleagues from the Upstate and Long Island Caucus, in addition to the members Espada and Parker from downstate as well. But this was a very important thing. And I also want to thank my colleagues on your committee, the Local Governments Committee, and making some input during the committee process that were addressed in the bill, too. Thank you.
Okay. Are there any other senators wishing to be heard on the bill? Hearing none, the debate is closed. Secretary, please ring the bell. Read the last section.
Section 2, this act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Adams, Espada, Kruger, Skelos, Smith, Young.
Announce the result.
Aye 62, nays 0.
The bill is passed. Senator Klein.
Madam President, is there any further business at the desk?
There's no further business at the desk.
There being none, Madam President, I move that we adjourn at the call of the temporary president, and I will inform my colleagues that they will be in session tomorrow, although the time is yet to be determined.
Senate is adjourned to the call of the president, session tomorrow, at a yet to be determined time.
62, Aaron. Okay.